Now, yesterday on the news program, Karratha man Barry Brown rang in to tell us about the strange sight he'd seen on the highway just out of Karratha. Two camels pulling a battered-looking vehicle along the road while a man walked alongside. Some of you rang in or sent text messages to say you'd seen this bloke as well, and it became obvious he'd been doing it for quite a while and he'd covered quite a bit of ground as well. His name's Klaus Menzel, and I had a chat with him yesterday about what he was doing.
Walking around his island, so that's pretty much it.
Why?
I get quite often, I get asked. I think probably the best one is, nobody tells me.
Nobody tells you what to do?
That's it.
You need to be free?
Yep.
Is it that?
Yeah. In 1993, things turned a bit, you know, upside down for me. And I was always contracting most of my life. And I had a contract up in Western Australia. You know, then I got 8 months, then I got 18 months before I went home again, and then the marriage broke down. So I was going to do a short-term job in Kalgoorlie, and I went to for a medical. The doctor just called me, he said, "Klaus, you're a walking disaster." He said, "Come back tomorrow, and we sit down, and we really talk about it." He really spend time with me. He said, come in there at 7 o'clock in the morning, I'm here. We got 2 hours before the first patients come in. We just sat and we talked, and he asked a bit about what happened in the family, you know. And then he told me, he said, "Klaus, you're only 45 now. I'm sick and tired of giving people like you, giving your tablets, and you just go out and you keep on going. You know, you have to change your lifestyle." I've been on the road now for 14 years, starting with a bicycle in 94.
Do you have any idea how many thousands of kilometres?
I don't know. At the moment we do about 20, 25 kilometres a day, and that's walking. On a bicycle you do 100 a day, or 80 is comfortable.
So I built that one. That was Christmas 1998. That's it, darling. They call it the McIntyre River up there. That's we coming down, you know, the boat is just circling around, and we got over the weir. The weir was 6 meters underneath us, and from there, where the Darling goes into the Murray at Wentworth, is about 2,500 kilometers. I went down with that one from Gundawindi to Mangandai. By road it's about 150 kilometers. Mm-hmm. On the river it's about 500, because of winding. Then just about at Naranda, the current got too strong. Just before Naranda, before the Yanko Weir, 80% of the water is diverted into the National Channel for rice and irrigation. Mm-hmm. So when I came over the weir, of course, a hell of a flow of water coming, and it took me to cover 20 kilometers from the weir to Naranda. Took me 6 days to get across there. And then I said, I was going to go to Gundagai all the way, but I turned around. The return trip was 2 hours. I was going that fast, I couldn't stop at the weir. I went right over the bloody top of it. Did a bit of damage. That was her after we went over the weir. That's in the mill. So I had to get underneath things. I would just fill up with water if I couldn't drag her up on the side, drag her underneath the logs or something. And I left her at Barrenald and went back to Mildura, and I built what I called amphibious. This photo here, you see, he came over for the christening of my boat. They call it the Chukchet. So I built her down there. She had just bicycle wheels on it. Later on, I replaced them with motorbike wheels. And I could put the pedals right into the spokes. So from land, I could go on water right away without changing anything. So The only problem was a bit brakes didn't work on it. This photo was taken then in Tipperborough, and that's above is a replica of Stuart's boat, what he took out to look for the inland sea. The boat has never been found, so I had a little quotation on it, amphibious under replica of Stuart's boat, which has never been found. Find one with wheels, not his, it's mine. My plan was to take this one up to the Cooper's Creek and then over to Lake Eyre. I had by then crossed with it 180 sand dunes, you know, pretty hard going. I would go 15 kilometers a day. That was my top speed. But I was moving on, and then I met Willie the camel man. He was coming up. I heard over the bush telegraph that somebody was behind me with four camels pulling a wagon and two behind.
When I seen him, I just asked him what he's up to, and he said, "I'm going to catch up some more camels." And we caught 14. Then I walked him back to Queensland with him, and I got two, Willie and Snowy.
Come on, boys, tucker time. Mine are born in captivity, and Willie didn't want the ones in captivity, out of captivity. He wanted wild ones. And it's probably a bit easier to train a wild one, because they got the fear of you. Willie, my older camel, wasn't too bad because he'd been on that trip, so he was used to being tied behind the wagon. His mite Snowy, both of my camels are brought up together as kids, running in a paddock down there, you know, never had anything badly done to him. I got started working with Willie a little bit. Snowy gave me a lot of trouble. Again, I was impatient. I didn't know enough about him. Billy the camelman helped me to put the nose back in, but I was present when we put the nose back into Snowy. The next day I put the nose line on and tried to lead him, stupid me, back to the same tree where we put the hole in his nose, away from his mite, and it's very hard to separate a camel from his mite. So I realized I was doing the wrong thing, and I took the nose line out, and instead of going backwards, I turned me back on him, and he just got me. He got me down on the ground. Lucky I was close to the fence, and I could roll out of his way. It cracked two of my ribs. I could not walk properly for about, certainly not laugh for about 6 weeks. But now they came, you know, I've been walking with them now. That was 2002. People told me, and Willie as well, "Oh, you're not tough enough for it. You don't flog your animals. You can't even flog your bloody dog." And I said, "Willie, I don't want to flog anything, you know." So I just took me time. The results, I've been walking with and living with them for 8 years now. 2002, yeah, for 8 years now. I don't have to look for them. They come looking for me. They're not scared anymore. Only Willie does the pulling. Snowy, you can forget about it. He is just bloody hopeless. And probably knows it too. You know, people say it's a lazy camel. I think it's a smart. They're running that fridge on the back. And I got my first one in 94 on my bicycle, and I haven't had an electricity bill ever since. So it works well, it runs the computer, light, and the fridge. There was one thing I really liked about Australia when I came in 1968. was the tolerance between different nationalities. You know, like me working on the construction site. Mm. I worked over at Mont Newman. There was 45 different nationalities, 25 different languages. English was only a very, very small part of it. We all got along pretty well. You know, the Vietnam demonstrations, like the peace demonstration, I was proud to be part of it. It never included the Aborigines here in that regard, but then during that time I didn't know, they're just coming out, they're getting their alcohol was allowed for them, they had their voting rights since 1967, since the referendum. That was my generation went through that. They go 10 years either side of me or down there. But then I look back at it and we're also the generation put again stuffed up. You know, it's sad. We had great dreams. Right, we've been dreaming, we've been marching for things, we're putting our views out in the open. There's not enough of it anymore. You know, when Iran, Iraq, war, Afghanistan, we didn't really care. A few people did, but the majority didn't really care anymore. Our politicians know best. In April 94, arbitrating in a mobile canal, we left Tananda in the Barossa Valley and headed pretty much for the center, a bit of a trail run through the Flinders Ranges. And then I came up to the turn off to Ayers Rock or Uluru, what it is called by the indigenous people. That was my first visit in 1994. My first real encounter with the indigenous people happened at Imamba, where I pulled in. There was a bit of work done as a boiler making on a community hall. And I never forget the first thing the kids come out and they said, "Are you police?" And I'm looking at Abby at that dog, it was a German Shepherd. And then it clicked with me, and I said, "No, I'm not police." "And what about him?" I said, "Him girl, him no police." "Him bite?" I said, "No, him girl, him no bite." So the next day I'm working up on the, or that afternoon the little kids came over with their dogs, and we had a bit of a training session. They wanted to turn all their dogs into police dogs. So the next morning I'm working on the school building, and Abby just chased something. I don't think it was a cat, maybe another dog or something like that. I was on top of the building, so I jumped down and I had the lead in my hand, but I couldn't catch Abby. She was just running. So there was two little kids playing in the sandbox at the school. One Aborigine kid and one white fella kid. So I don't know why I did it. I had the lead in my hand and I put it on the neck of the Aborigine kid down there, and I said, "No, you, my dog." And the white kid turned around. "He is not a dog, he is my friend." Later on, I met the mother. She was a school teacher of the white kid, and we talked. They've been about 4 or 5 years old. Both kids going in and out of school. Both are reading and writing already. And I thought it would be nice if these two kids, both of them highly intelligent, one of them be the president and one the prime minister of this country. One can only hope. From there I went up to Uluru, just watching it from a distance. There was another two cyclists with me, and I looked over there, and there's this. I said to Tim, an Irish cyclist, I said, "Look at Tim, it's funny, there's this bare rock and there goes a tree line all the way up. My eyesight is not the best." And Tim said, "No, that's silly people, what about running?" running up and down. I never forget the feeling of it. It's, I seen the caves on the bottom, what is very important to their storytelling. There is, but you should be very careful with taking photographs. If these photos, what I got on here, would make people leaving their cameras behind when they go to the rock and look. You can't really stop people climbing on it. You know, I wish people would have the sense not to climb, just to show respect. And after about 2 days, or maybe been 3 days, one of the elders came over to me and said, "You like to stay a night? It's not allowed to stay over at Uluru at night." I said, "Yes, but what, I got me dog in the camp." He said, "Oh, you police dog. I think Abby got very well known. She's invited as well." So I spent the night by myself on the base of Uluru. And I think it was a great privilege to be invited by the indigenous people, or by one of the elders, to stay down there. From there I went up to the Olgas. That's about 50 kilometers from there, and I spent 3 or 4 days, I don't know, I lost track of time. But that really solved my problems. I took the time to think about one of my decision then, never to borrow any more money, never to worry about what happened in 2 or 3 days. If I got taka today, if I got taka tomorrow, that's fine. Everything else will come. I've been through the center. I really like the center. I walked around the center for about 3 years, never going close to the rock. I love to see it in the distance, like the rest of the country. Visit communities like Hermannsburg, and always been made or felt that I was welcome. I'm born in 1948 in Germany. That's after the war. I come out of a town, we had 6,000 people. We had 24 pubs, and all pubs are making money. We could buy beer everywhere, but we also had a big alcohol problem. I was 18 when I applied for Australia. I was knocked back because of high blood pressure and liver damage by the time I was 18. And the high blood pressure might run a little bit in the family, but the liver damage was done by myself through alcohol by the age of 18. I started drinking when I was 14. It was quite acceptable in our town, and it's a beautiful little town. As soon as you started working, you could go into the pub, stick a cigarette in your mouth, and ask for a beer, and you'd be served if you started off an apprenticeship. The violence down there, my father was a very, well, I really got no good memories about him. He was a very violent alcoholic, not outside, but coming home. Mum would cop it, and if he could find, we would cop it. So Mum would be hiding us, and she worked very, very hard for it. And that's not an isolated case. I can go down my street in me mind, and at least every second house had an alcohol problem. That was for people living in houses. These things would climb even a higher proportion of alcohol in camps out of town, where the people came would be made homeless from Poland back to Germany because they had Polish ancestors. That alcohol problem was even bigger. And none of the conditions in them camps. Not that I'm an expert, because I've been born 1948, but in 1955-60, none of the conditions would have been anywhere close to the condition people live even today in communities. So what do you think is coming out of it? The problem will not go away. The next generation might be a lot angrier than the previous generation. I don't want them to be angry. I want them to have the opportunities. But I could not understand if they weren't angry, if you know what I mean. They had to be angry. There's other nations in the world. I worked in Africa and people like that. These people got the right to live. But we always hear productivity or the like. Forget about it. You know, somebody said, oh, we give him all the handouts and we make him the welfare defense. What a lot of cocky shit that is. 2007, I decided to walk up the Central Highway to the West Coast, to Steep Point, and I stopped in Cosmos Newberry, a very small community, maybe 150 people, and I camped a little bit outside. The next day I got invited to come over to the school, only had about 8 kids at the school. The teacher had come back after living in Perth for a long time for her children's education, then came back to Cosmos Newberry and found a girl by Margaret. You can see her on the photo. Margaret, probably, I don't know, 21, 22, had one child, and she worked together with the teacher, and the teacher's ambition is to hand the school over to Margaret, helping her in correspondence course. 2 years later, I'm walking up the Gip River Road. There comes Margaret Pass with a view going to a wedding at Kananar. And I said, Margaret, how you go? And she said, another 3 months. And I got my teaching degree. And I could only hope that more like that would happen, but a lot of the changes and the real changes for them been happening under their own steam, under strong leadership from their elders, and community life. So when this intervention came in 3 years ago, and all this talk, and nobody can tell me any difference, I was made up after there was no children going overboard, there was no, they looked for a reason to win the next election, and brought in that intervention. And I've been thinking about it quite a few times, only a couple of days ago. Also, it's my opinion, and I don't know about anyone else, it was a blatant land grab to get the communities for on Aboriginal land, to get them on lease land. It's always said, we want them indigenous people to have the same rights. Yes, fine, but I think what was deep down was behind to get them to sell, make it private land, that private people can sell it. The land will finish up in white fellas' land, and we only interested what is underneath the ground, and the indigenous people will finish up with nothing. But I think whoever got that hope is kidding himself. They got enough leadership, you know, I don't know enough of it, that will not happen. And I hope it will not happen. Yeah. Their culture, we can talk, I don't know Now what makes me happy every time when I hear it, the kids speak their own language. And there is, I don't know how many hundred different languages in there, but even the children bring the education in, they talk their own language, and good on them. So, I've been living on the side of the road now for 16 years, and I always been treated with respect by the youngest and the older people, and I treat them in return with respect, and that will get us a long way.
You're constantly talking to them. Out in the bush, nobody talks to me, eh? Hey? Only this willy boy, eh? Hey? We talk a lot of things away. It will take generations for, if ever, for them to make a human living condition. Not as humanly possible, just make a human living condition in there. If there is a child, if the schooling, because there is not much work out after, if a kid shows any potential and willingness to learn, even if it means a one-to-one teaching. Every person there is, like Margaret, the teacher, her son or her daughter will have somebody to look up to when they grow up and maybe become something else who's certainly capable of doing it.